question for you guys up here on stage.
I don't have an answer.
Okay, you have an answer? Good. So, are these guys kind of scary to look at?
Yes.
Because here's why, man. I heard you guys this last week, and you sang this song, and you rocked this roof. You were a little quiet today, and I'm going to blame them, okay? They're a little bit, you got to get, I had to get used to them, all right? So you do too, but that's right. During the week, there was 85 of you, all right? And so thank you for being here. Thank you for taking time on a holiday weekend to come and sing for us. All right, go to Sunday school. Okay, guys, head right out those doors, and our worship team is going to lead us in worship. 85 to 88 kids Monday through Friday night right here in this room, and they rock the place, man. If you missed last Sunday and you didn't get to see the stage set up, all right, Clark Cavern, all right, was here all week sharing messages with them, and he was a cave guy, and go on the Facebook page. Because it was just an awesome, incredible stage setup for our kids all week. So we're glad they came in and say, always good to have my twin brother here for worship. We had him last week. We get him next week, all right? 3 weeks in a row. So what are we doing to start with? I have no idea.
God's not dead.
God's not dead. Let's stand. Thank you. Happy 4th of July weekend. I am so glad you chose not to go to the mountains or the beach. I would have been preaching to an empty sanctuary otherwise, so thanks for being here today. Don't begrudge those who did. They're in cooler weather, all right? Grateful for that. I'm sure they'll be back next week, but we are so glad you're here. If you are a guest today, it's your first time at New Hope, thank you for coming. You honor us by the choice you've made. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to pull one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag next week through the mail. We'll send you information of what goes on around New Hope. We promise. We'll not beat on your door or pester you on the phone, but through the mail, give you information that will answer a lot of your questions about New Hope Church. Real quick, I want to recognize two folks who are here today. First of all, Don McGinley. Stand up, girl. Just back last night about 7:30 from Uganda, Africa. All right. The rest of our mission team that went, Bill and Lindsay and Ryan and Alyssa and Brittany. And Brittany is driving to high school camp today. Yeah, she's coming back tonight. I said, I sure hope somebody goes with her to come back tonight, all right? Because she's going to go on adrenaline up, but coming back, that adrenaline's going to dip. Trust me, 2 weeks in Africa, it's tough. We can't wait to hear more about them in the weeks to come, but we're so excited they went, and we are very excited that they got back, and all is well. In fact, they brought me a bookmark, and this bookmark is made out of wood, all right? And it was made there. So we'll get more to that story one of these days soon. But anyway, they brought that back. So we're so very, very grateful for that. The other person I want to recognize, Joe Crawford with us today. Joe, stand up. Formerly our youth pastor here at New Hope Church. I loved it when Joe was here because I could say I had the oldest pastor for youth in the state of California, all right? Man, we had 5 great years together, and we watched our kids grow up together through the high school program, and he is a grandpa for the 10th time this week, all right? He's doing with his grandkids what he did with his own kids. He has his own youth department, okay? So it's exciting. It's exciting. It's great to have Joe. We've maintained a wonderful relationship in spite of many miles between us, and those miles are getting more because he and his wife, Jeannie, have relocated now to where their sons live in Colorado. And so he's going to be here this week, and it's good to have him in worship with us today. And we're glad for the rest of you as well. Let me highlight a few announcements and a couple of updates on prayer requests, and then we'll get engaged in our worship today. Homeless outreach is today. All right, so if you've been engaged in a homeless outreach, it's going to be today. The information's in the bulletin. You can see Debbie Blankenship after the service or between services or call her right after the last one. They'll be serving at the rescue mission, and if you need particular information, please touch base with them if you don't have it already today. We've already let you know that we've wrapped up our week of vacation Bible school, and the building is still standing. all right, and everything is pretty much back to normal, and we are so grateful for everybody who volunteered to help. Jennifer, who directed it for us, did just a terrific job, but it's an impossible job without literally dozens and dozens of volunteers. I think we had over 60 volunteers from between setup to serving to teaching to clean up after it's over. And guys, I want you to understand, cleanup is every bit a part of ministry as all the rest of it is. We've been trying to impress upon our staff that ministry is not finished until cleanup is concluded, okay? Because it's in order to be ready for the next thing, all right? We got to be able to start. And so cleanup is part of it. And we've gotten to where we've added cleanup crews for volunteer, all right? Because it's just, and some people say, well, I can't get in front of kids and teach. No, but you can put all the stuff away when it's over, all right? And, man, I was told Saturday morning by Mark that, man, the cleanup crew around here, they were finished just like that. And they were laughing and cracking up and having, and that's wonderful. But that's part of the ministry as well. So we say thank you to all of that. After our third service today, our high school kids are heading to camp. 32 high school kids going to camp this year. I think probably the biggest group since your days, Joe. All right, to have 32 going. And we're pretty excited about that. So be praying for them as they leave today. Fireworks booth is out, set up, ready to go. If you need fireworks, buy them before you leave the property today. That sent a kid to camp. Okay? I want you to understand how I said that. That sent a kid to camp. That's our junior high fundraiser, and they're already back from camp. So do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah, some of them got credit, okay? So right now, we fronted them the money. The way they pay that back is because they're working there, and so the sales goes to fund junior high camp, all right? So that was grace and faith in advance, all right? So get out there today or come back tomorrow and pick up your fireworks there. Please take note, there's a special event coming up for our Jams kids in just a couple of weeks on a Wednesday night. You can see Fawn or contact Fawn. Fawn, stand up so everybody knows who you are, all right? Fawn. No, I'm moving on to women now. Giggles, yeah. Giggles and goodies, all right, coming up in August. So contact Fawn either personally or by email, and she will get those tickets for that special evening. And it's a wonderful time to bring a guest that would might not come to church any other way, all right, but they'll come for laughs and food. So come and enjoy a very special night. We'll talk more about the Fresno Grizzlies, but get that date on your calendar. That's Christian Music Night at Grizzly Stadium. There's an insert in your bulletin, all right. I probably ought to have my head examined for adding something else during the summer, but as Shelly and I were going through Right Now Media, looking for some other things that we might want to do next year, came across this little Bible study called You and Me Forever, done by Francis Chan, and I was blown away by it. And so I know a lot of small groups don't meet during the summer, and so I'm going to take advantage of that opportunity. So on Tuesday nights, for about an hour and 10 minutes, okay, we're going to do a study here at the church on marriage. Let me tell you guys, this is one you're going to want to come to. And here's why. Because we're not going to say one word about communication and your poor listening skills. Not one word is going to be mentioned about that, because actually, what blew me away about this study is this is not about looking where you are now and where do you want to be a month from now. This is about how in our marriages we look at eternity. We look at when life and marriage is finished on this earth with us, what have we done as a spouse to make your entrance into heaven and hearing the words of the great groom himself, Jesus Christ, enter in, my good and my faithful servant. What are we doing as a husband? What are y'all doing as a wife to enable your husband, your wife, to hear those words with even deeper and more meaning than you ever thought was possible? That's what this is about. And so, you want to join us? Here's the deal. Books are $10. You can download them on your iPad or your Kindle, okay, for free. But I need to know if you're coming, if you need a book, so that we have them here for the first session. So sign-up sheets are coming around, all right? This one already went around in the 8 o'clock service, so there's a few names on it yet. This one hasn't been around anywhere. If you're going to attend, and this is something, you don't have to be young married. You don't have to be mid-course married. You can be married like the Wrights will be next weekend. 70 years for the Wrights next weekend. I'm pointing that out because they won't be with us next weekend. Something like a second honeymoon or something they're going on all the way to Bakersfield. There's more to that story, but don't take the time now. Anyway, they actually got to celebrate last week because they got to watch their grandsons compete in the swimming Olympic trials this last week. Pretty awesome, incredible stuff. All right. One of them just 1 second behind Michael Phelps. All right, that was pretty dang good, let me tell you. So anyway, this is for any stage. And you know what? If you're single, do you think someday you may be married? Be a great class to come to. All right, great, great. Child care will be provided. Please let us know how many children you'll need care for. All right, determines how many straitjackets that we rent for the week. Okay, just kidding. But let us know if you need a book, okay? Under email area, let us know where if you need a book and how many, one or two, okay? So we make sure we get enough here. So we'll be excited to share that time with you. It's going to start July 12th, end, I think, August the 23rd, all right? Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests. Shelly is not with me today. She has been down sick since about midnight Wednesday night. She kind of has been running north and south at the same time. That's the kindest way I could describe it to y'all, all right? That ended about 7 o'clock last evening, and she thought she was coming today, and I said, you're not coming today. And so anyway, she's home recuperating. I want you to be remembering Bill Richardson's family, memorial service that we had Friday morning, and part of his family attends our church here. And let me tell you a quick story, because this I love stories. That I get to hear these stories for one reason. It's because I get to visit with the family in preparation for their service. And so I find out things I would never know any other way. Bill Richardson, after high school, joined the Marines. And when he came home on leave from the Marines, he was at his house, and he, across the street, was a young lady he had never seen before. And he saw her, and he was instantly in love. He told his best friend, who was standing on the yard with him, I'm going to marry that girl. And he went out that night, and he bought a wedding ring. The next day, he got shipped back to 29 Palms, to his base. He didn't have a name. He did not have a phone number. But he had a wedding ring. He got discharged several months later, came home. He was asked, who had lived next to for a long time, his neighbors asked him, hey, we've got our regular babysitter coming to look after our son, but she has another job and she'll be about 30 minutes late. Could you watch our son for half an hour till the babysitter gets here? He said, sure. Guess who walked in the door is the babysitter. Yeah. The gal he had a ring in his pocket for. So he asked her on a date. They went on a date the next week, their first date. That ring burned a hole in his pocket. He proposed on the first date. And they got married 2 weeks later. And that was 57 years ago. That is incredible. That is just incredible. I love that story. And don't either one of you try that, okay? Just don't try that. But anyway, great time with their family. Continue to pray for their family. I know it would mean so much. And actually, I know that very day, one of the other relatives was heading off to a cancer appointment that day. So I want you to be remembering them. Leaving tomorrow for Roseville to start cancer treatment is Bernice Osborne's daughter. And just found out last week that she has acute leukemia. And so that procedure will start tomorrow very, very quickly. So please be in prayer for them as they travel, as they're out of town and going through all of this treatment. All of our Uganda people are back. I got a word through, I haven't seen her here yet, maybe it'll be the third service, but through Facebook I got a message that Jan Patton is going to be with us today. First time back in church after her attack. So we'll be excited about that and look forward to her in the next service. Mike Cousineau will also be with us at the end of the month talking about 1040i and the next Ivory Coast Mexico mission trip next February. So be looking forward to updates on that. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, I love you. Thank you for the incredible privilege of sharing life with you every single moment of every single day. Forgive us for those moments when we think that we can do it on our own or out of neglect, we just simply forget. Father, thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit within us, who is a very good reminder of the things that we forget. And I pray that within growing improvement within our lives, we will respond quickly to the nudges and the reminders, the whispers of the Holy Spirit in our life that says, don't make that decision, don't do that job, don't share your thoughts without first listening to me. Father, I trust we will develop really, really good ears to hear your voice in our lives. And that, Father, we won't even attempt the easy things in life without trusting you, without depending on you. We commit to you the needs that we've already shared today for the Richardson family and your care and comfort in their lives. Lord, for the Osborne family, for Charlene and the treatment that she will start on Tuesday. Not only do we pray for her body, but Father, I pray for her spirit as well. That Father, though the body may be struggling with disease and sickness, I pray that her heart and her soul will be strong and healthy as she depends upon you. No sickness, no disease there, because her life is invested in you. Father, for those who've battled smaller things in the adventure of this past week, we trust you with those. For families that are going through some pretty complex issues, thank you that what is complex from our side of life is not as difficult as creation from your side, and you didn't have any problem with creation. And so, Father, we trust you with those needs. For our high school kids as they head to camp, I trust there will be some remarkable life transformation moments take place this year at church camp. I am often remembered of one particular transforming moment in my own life that took place at Hume Lake Christian Camp. So, Father, I pray for others that those decisions will be made and they'll be long-lasting. Father, we rejoice with the Wrights and their 70 years of marriage, and thank you for the privilege of having fellowship with them. Lord, for all that you want to say and do in our midst today, may we have listening ears and, most of all, obedient wills. Dear Lord, for the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks. An expression of our deep gratitude and our confidence in you. We do all this in the only name we have a right and a reason and a purpose to pray. The name of your Son, our Savior, Lord, and Master, Jesus Christ. Amen. I don't know about y'all, but I think that was a good call. All right. I invite you to take your Bibles and find Psalm 100. Find the 100th division of the song, hymn number 100. It's probably the national anthem of the Old Testament, and we're going to look at it today. If you're new, often I spend a few minutes, all right, kind of review. I'm not doing that today. There's some review notes in your bulletin, and you can go back and watch it on the website, all right, if you want to get caught up. But we're just going to kind of jump right in. We're on a less, more lifestyle. What are the things in my life I need less of me so that I can have more of Him seen in me? And one of the steps in developing this less, more lifestyle, the final step really, is the step of contemplation. That is the slow, steady thinking about the Scriptures and the character and the nature of God in our life. And there is no better book in the Bible, Old or New Testament, for contemplation than the book of Psalms, the book of hymns. And so today we are looking at Psalm 100. Let's read it, and then we'll make some observations about it. I'll be honest, I memorized this as a child. I memorized this in King James language. So when I read the NIV, sometimes I have to blend the two. So if in my reading of it, you say, where'd those extra words come from? Just know it's me supplementing NIV with the way in which I memorized it. And there are some phrases I like the old better than I do the new. In other occasions, it's the other way around. So today it'll kind of be a blended passage. The way I learned verse 1 was make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And I got to be honest, I'm partial to making a joyful noise. And the reason is I learned at a very early age I could not carry a tune in a bucket. So the fact that this started out with a joyful noise was comforting to me that I could be included in this public expression of worship. All right? This one says, shout for the joy of the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who has made us, and we are His. I memorized that phrase a little bit differently. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are not to be self-made people. We live in a country and a nation and a society that really promotes being pulled up by your own bootstraps. And all that means is you're just walking in deeper doo-doo. Okay? Quite frankly, is all that means. We need to allow God to pull us out of the pit. We are His people. We are the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name, for the Lord is good and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. I've kind of titled today's passage, Worship with All You've Got, the Best You Can. Worship with all you've got, the best you can. I suggest to you, it's not only the way to worship, it's the way to live life. Live life in Christ with all you've got, the best you can. While we have experienced financial ups and downs in the last century, some of the downs have been very significant, and we got to be honest, some of the ups have been pretty good too. We nevertheless have benefited from an unprecedented level of abundance in this nation. Never in human history have so many people lived in the kind of comfort that we live in today. American culture leads the world in luxury. Many families have driveways with multiple cars in them. A house filled with modern appliances, most of those dedicated to our entertainment. Here's the newest one I've just heard about. Remote control flusher. Just push a button, it flushes. All right? Yeah, I think that's cool. I'll never own one, but I think it's kind of cool. We all have closets full of clothes, and most of us refrigerators full of food. Unfortunately, in these days of abundance and wealth, we tend to become very ungrateful, even presumptuous. And by the way, there is a very quick remedy for this. A mission trip to Africa. Okay, pretty quick remedy. Oh, I don't want to go. That's all right. Go anyway. I didn't want to go. Now I can't wait to go again. Instead of thanking God, we have a tendency to develop a spirit of entitlement. I got to be honest. I just said this to Shelley night before last after a particular commercial aired. I said, I'm growing very tired of the commercials that say, you deserve this. I deserve this. Whatever it is they're selling. From McDonald's, who says you deserve this break today, to a cruise, to LeBron James selling solo headsets saying, I deserve the best. Ladies and gentlemen, if we don't deserve a Savior, then why in the world should we deserve the stuff of this world? We don't deserve it. We might be able to afford it. We may have been able to work hard so that we could pay for it. But guys, we don't deserve it. Please don't misunderstand. Abundance is not sinful. Scripture describes a number of people who were both wealthy and godly. Abraham, Job, Joseph, David, Solomon, Josiah, Barnabas, Lydia, just to name a few. But we can also find in the Scripture some who become enamored of their wealth and they lost the sight of the Lord and His right to rule their lives. And that is a principle that you and I need to nail down in our life. God does deserve the right to rule our lives. If we want to talk about rights and entitlements and deserving. The one who laid his life down on a cross for no sin that he had ever committed, but paid a debt for every sin that I've ever committed, thought, or imagined. He deserves the right to rule my life. He loves me more than I love myself, and he knows what's best for us. He deserves it. We don't. There's nothing wrong with having nice things, but trouble brews in our life when nice things have us. The spirit of entitlement can quickly overshadow an attitude of generosity and humility. And Psalm 100 is a song of celebration that I believe can help restore a spirit of thankfulness and joyful gratitude, just as hearing the national anthem reminds me of what our forefathers did to provide us with the opportunities we have today. Psalm 100 reminds us of gratitude and thankfulness. As we take a closer look at this psalm, three questions pop into my mind. Let me highlight those three questions quickly for you. Number one, to whom is this psalm addressed? Verses 1 and 5 state that it is intended for all the earth to sing. That tells me that Psalm 100 is for every single one of us. It's for every nation. It's for every culture. It is for every age group. It is for every stage in life. The message is universal. It's for every one of us to hear and to apply its meaning to our own lives. Of whom does this psalm speak? Verses 1 through 3 along with verse 5 give us clearly the answer of whom this psalm is addressed. Psalm 100 speaks of the Lord. His name appears 4 times in 5 verses, and one of the times he is declared by God himself. This psalm directs our attention to Yahweh. We talked about that several weeks ago, what that word really means. But the easiest way I can define it and the quickest way is this. It's the Old Testament version of a personal name for God. It's like you and me being able to say to our earthly father, "Oh, Daddy, oh, Daddy." We cannot appreciate Psalm 100 or apply its message if we do not know the one of whom we speak. The more we become intimately acquainted with the Almighty, the infinite Creator, the deeper this song resonates within a grateful soul. Being thankful, I mean really, really thankful, begins in a right relationship with the giver of everything. And the third question is, how is this song arranged? You know, verse and chorus. See, psalms were originally written as hymns for the Old Testament. They are poetic in their form. Hebrew lyrics don't rhyme like English poetry, but they follow a style, a meter. There's kind of a cadence to it. It's the reason when I quote Scripture, I often fall back to King James, because that translation in the English tried to maintain the cadence. And when you get a rhythm going, it's easier to remember it. NIV focused strictly on interpretation, which is really good. Okay? But cadence is what they, because they could remember. It's like a song. You get a tune in your head. The cadence of that song all of a sudden brings the words to you. And that's the way in which these were written. Each psalm stands alone like every song in our hymnal in the pew. They're independent of the one before it or after it. But they all have their own distinct message and arrangement. This particular song in just 5 verses gives us 7 commands. And it concludes in its final verse with the character of God, which is the reason we ought to obey the 7 commands. Let me just highlight quickly the 7 commands. Notice in verse 1, it says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord." Okay, did I wake up your babies yet? Okay. It says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord." What does shout mean? Yeah, there's my daddy back there. Yeah. Can you shout quietly? You really can't. It's not a shout if you do it quietly. All right. So let's. I want you a little experiment here. We want to be obedient right off the bat. Right. Okay. The first command is shout to the Lord. All right. So I'm going to count to 3, and I want you to say the Lord in a shout. Okay. 1, 2, 3. That wasn't bad, but I heard 83 VBS kids do better than that this last week. So we're going to do it one more time. This is a shout. This is what my mama used to say, use your outside voice. Now, there were occasions my mama said when I was inside, don't use your outside voice, okay, inside, all right? But quite frankly, I think I only have an outside voice. don't ask me to whisper something in your ear if you want it to be a secret, okay? That one doesn't work for me very well. So here we go. We're going to try it again. Shout to the Lord. One, two, three. The Lord! Oh, good. Don't you feel better? And there's just something about releasing that just... And this is his first command. First command, shout to the Lord. Number two, serve the Lord with gladness. Number three, come before him with joyful singing. It doesn't say beautiful singing. It doesn't say on-key singing. It doesn't say that you can keep the melody singing. It says simply sing joyfully. That includes all of us who are here. It says know that the Lord himself is God. Fifth command, enter his gate with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Here's a little kicker. You all have done that today. You've kept, this is command number five. You've kept number five today. The people in the mountain and the beach, they're not keeping that one today. I'm not downing them. I'm not dishing them. I'm just saying today they didn't keep that one. Now, I know people, some of you have told me, Pastor, I worship the Lord when I'm in the mountains and when I'm on the beach. Probably not, okay? No, you might not, but when we get away, we have a tendency to, sometimes we do it if it's, you know, but this, and I've had people tell me, Pastor, I can be a Christian without going to church. Probably so, and if you want to be weak and anemic all your life, that's okay. Because this is a command. This is an imperative term. All seven of these words are in the Hebrew imperative. These are not suggestions. This says, enter his courts. Okay? Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. This was written to the Hebrew people about going to the tabernacle and the temple. This is going to the place of worship, and you do this together. This is not what you can do by yourself on your own. You're still to do that. But this is God telling his people, you are to make the effort to enter my courts, and you come here for a purpose, and that is to praise me. Number six, give thanks to him. Number seven, bless his name. These are in the same imperative that the Ten Commandments are given. These are not suggestions. These are, if you have a relationship with God, if you want that relationship to be good and healthy, shout, serve, come, know, enter, give, bless. God's character is what gives us the reason to obey these commands, to obey these directives, to celebrate and worship, have their roots in the character of this one that we come to give gratitude to. And in these five verses, there are three quick facts. Fact number one, verses 3 and 5 both say this, he is God and he is good. He is God and he is good. He is a good God. Fact number two, his loving kindness is everlasting. God does not get tired of loving you and being kind to us. Aren't you glad? Have you ever grown a little weary of being kind and loving to somebody? For some of you, it could be me. For some of you, for me, it's some of y'all. Okay? But we've been there. The scripture says here, this God that we can give gratitude to, he never gets tired of being kind to us. He never grows weary in loving us. That's worth gratitude, isn't it? And fact number three, this God that we are to worship and give thanks to, he is faithful to all generations. The Lord is consistent from the beginning until the very end of time. That consistency, that changelessness is what you and I can root our lives in. We don't praise and worship the Lord because of what we're going to get back from him in return. He calls for worship as a natural response to our firsthand experience of God's character, which presumes we have a firsthand experience of God's character. Do you know where the firsthand experience of God's character comes in? When we meet him. When we meet him. I knew of Tim Keppler before I met Tim Keppler. How did I know of Tim Keppler before I met Tim Keppler? Because Joe Avila gave me a CD. And I heard Tim Keppler on a CD first. If my memory's correct, it actually was at Fresno High Auditorium, I think. It's the first time we met face to face. Okay? There is something different about me listening to Tim Keppler on a CD than it is me standing on a stage shaking his hand and when the evening was over hugging his neck. I now have firsthand experience with him. Firsthand experience with God is the moment that we are born again. The moment that we invite Jesus to forgive us of our sins, come live within our life, and we become known as a child of God. Not as a Baptist or a Presbyterian or a Methodist or a Catholic, but we become known as a child of God. It is clear that the writer of Psalm 100 is calling us to look up. Everything in those seven imperatives about drawing our attention to God, to see the blessings that come from God. Warren Wiersbe, you want to put a guy right up there with Ray Steadman that I told you about a couple of weeks ago, all right? And I've had three or four of you, you've gone out and you've bought some Ray Steadman books. Thank you very much, all right? Keep doing it because you're reading a good guy. Warren Wiersbe's in that same caliber of writers and preachers. He puts the subject this way. He said, some people are appreciative by nature. Do you know some folks? Are there relatives in your life that, man, they're just always very, very grateful, always very, very appreciative? And then there are some who are not. You got any of those in your family? Your circle of friends? You never, ever can do enough for them. It's never, ever satisfactory. Let me ask a question. When you look in the mirror, what do you see? A person filled with gratitude, always appreciative, or someone always wanting more? You see, it's these latter people who especially needs God's power in them to express thanksgiving. We should remember that every good gift comes from God and that He is, as the theologians put it, He is the source, the support, and He is the end of all things. The very breath in our mouths is the free gift of God. As you stand by a graveside, you have walked as far as you can humanly walk with somebody else that you know and love. And if you expect that grave to be something more than just a dead-end street, you better have a relationship, not with the people who are standing around that grave, as wonderful as every one of them may have been in your life, but you have a better have a relationship with the one who has walked through that grave and gives us an escape route to a dead-end street. And His name is Jesus Christ. Because death is not your final destination. It's either heaven or it's hell. And the dead-end street that we call a grave is simply a passageway to one or the other. And what you do with Christ in this life makes a determination of where you spend all of eternity. Thankfulness is the opposite of selfishness. The selfish person says, I deserve what comes to me. Other people need to make me happy. But the mature believer realizes that life is a gift from God and the blessings of life come only from His bountiful hand. Bishop Gerland Kennedy of California tells the true story of a shipwreck off the coast of Evanston, Illinois that happened several decades ago. The students of Northwestern University came to the rescue. One student, whose name was Edward Spencer, personally saved the lives of 17 individuals that day. Years later, a reporter was writing a follow-up story on that event, and he went to interview the now elderly Spencer. When asked what was the one thing that stood out about that incident in his mind, Spencer replied, I remember that of the 17 people I rescued that day, not a one of them said thanks. Not a one. It seems strange, doesn't it, that we need to be reminded to give thanks? But this is specifically what the text in Psalm 100 is all about. The text was thought to be the beginning hymn of a Thanksgiving service with a procession of worshipers. They would sing as they entered the temple. It was their call to worship, and more importantly, it was a call for us to give thanks. See, a lifestyle of worship includes giving thanks with all we've got, the best we can. As I was thinking of passages that pertain to this text today, there were a couple of Bible stories that came to mind. One of them is found in Luke 17, verses 11 through 19. Just write that down, read it later at your own convenience. But that passage is a story of Jesus healing 10 men who were lepers. All 10 of them had asked Jesus if he would heal them, and all 10 of them got an affirmative answer. All 10 of them were healed. Out of those 10 who were healed, only one came back and said thanks. And do you know who the one was? He was a Samaritan, what they called in those days a half-breed. He was looked down upon by everybody else, and out of the 10, the others being good Jewish people, the only one who came back was a Samaritan. And in verse 16 it says, he threw himself at Jesus' feet and with a loud voice he thanked him. One other text came to my mind. It's one that I remember my dad using in church from time to time as a kid growing up. He would quote a passage out of Psalm 107. Let the redeemed of the Lord... Ah, a few of you did it. That wasn't very loud though, was it? So let me do it. And this is the way my dad would do it sometimes in church. Let the redeemed of the Lord. Let the redeemed of the Lord. Let the redeemed of the Lord. All right, loud. Shout. It's what it says. The rest of that passage goes this way. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from the east and the west and the north and the south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city that they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight path to a city where they could live. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men, for he satisfies the thirsty and he fills the hungry with good things. This passage continues by telling of other occurrences where people found themselves in deep distress time and time and time again. And the living God heard their cry for mercy and he delivered them. And the psalmist states after each deliverance in verse 8, in verse 15, in verse 21, in verse 31, let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for me. By now, you and I ought to get the picture. But again, I'm going to say to you, are you and I like each of these in Psalm 107 that was delivered from some great crisis and we still need to be reminded to give thanks? It seems so easy in this life to forget from whom, where we came, and to take completely for granted all that God has done for us personally and also for what he has done for our families, for our community, for our church fellowship, for our nation, and the list goes on. So now we come back to the text of Psalm 100. The psalmist states that it's time to worship. According to this passage, what does real worship of the living God look like? The song indicates strongly that worship ought to be filled with thanksgiving and gratitude. Let me highlight just a couple of quick thoughts. Number one, thanksgiving is about exuberance. You don't hear too many sermons on exuberance in church, but that's the way this song starts out. Exuberance is acknowledging with enthusiasm what God has done. Shout! Make a joyful noise, joy-filled noise. Remember the healed Samaritan leper, verse 15 of Luke 17. It says he came back praising God in a loud voice. I'm going to have some of you go home and all you're going to remember is Tim shouted a lot in church today. Exuberance. Exuberance is being real with God as we praise him. Shout for joy to the Lord. Make this joy-filled noise. The hymn writer knew that coming into the sanctuary should lead to joy and celebration. He still calls us today. There's another song I learned growing up that says, get all excited, go tell everybody that Jesus Christ is King. We're often a lot like a little boy who was given an orange by a man. And the boy's mother asked her son, what do you say to the nice man? The little boy thought, and he handed the orange back to the man and said, peel it. And that's funny coming from a little boy. It's pretty sad coming from us to God. When God has given us so much and we're handing stuff back saying, you haven't done enough, God. Peel it. Thanksgiving is also not about exuberance, it's about worship. Worship is about being glad. How'd you arrive at church today, glad or mad? Trust me, pastors' families can get easily mad on Sundays more than any day of the week. It happens less since Chad, Brant, and Ashley aren't home with us, but just kidding, Ashley. When we're the only one who lives in our house, boy, it's easier to be glad, isn't it? Well, I'm not so sure. We can make ourselves pretty agitated. The Hebrew word for worship can be translated serve. Serve and worship. Thanksgiving is not just about lip service, it is about whole service. Thanksgiving is not just about service, but it's about being glad in doing the service. As Mark Addis explained to me, the cleanup crew on Friday night from BVS, he said, Tim, he said, they were laughing, cracking jokes, singing as they were putting all this stuff away. That's awesome. That is service that is glad. 60 volunteers giving to 88 kids every night when it's been 108 at the beginning of VBS. Serving with gladness. Worship is not only about being glad, but it's about singing. Singing in the presence of the Lord. I have noticed how blessed some people get over music. Man, music stirs our emotions. It moves our hearts. It challenges our thinking. And there's a lot of people who I know enjoy the music much more than they enjoy the message. That makes me a little nervous sometimes, but it's okay. I've gotten used to it. The scripture says we should come before Him. In regions of Mexico, there are hot springs and cold springs that are found right next to each other. And because of the convenience of this national phenomenon, the women often bring their laundry and they boil the clothes in the hot springs and then they rinse them in the cold springs. A tourist watching this procedure commented to their Hispanic guide, and they asked, they must think Mother Nature is generous to freely supply such ample, clean, and hot running water. And the guy replied, no, señor. There is much grumbling because she supplies no soap. And I wonder how much we are just like that. We grumble about what we don't have. Number three, wrapping this up, Thanksgiving is about knowing. Knowing is having our story straight. Our worship is not to be foolish or misdirected. It's why God gives us seven imperatives right here. He said, I'm going to make this clear what your worship ought to be like. I'm not going to leave this. You need to know this about me. Know that the Lord you're worshiping, He is God. It's about getting our story straight and sticking to it. This is an issue of faith and trust. It's acknowledgement of God for who He is. It's knowing that this is an interpersonal relationship between us and God. This passage says that He is God and we are the sheep of His pasture. Do you realize what God just did in that statement? He claimed you. He claimed me. You got any relatives you don't claim? I remember my dad one time talking about one of his cousins. He said, I know the cousin was rolling, and he said, that's from June's side of the family. Okay. And we all got some of those somewhere, don't we? All right? And yet God, if anybody had a reason not to claim us, it's God. And yet He said, you are the sheep of my pasture. And here's the kicker, folks. If we are not the sheep in His pasture, then we are a goat in Satan's pasture. There's no middle ground. There is no transition gate, folks. You are the sheep in the green pastures of God, or you are a goat in the wilderness of Satan. No middle ground. Knowing is important. A Sunday school teacher asked her class what they were thankful for. And a little girl said, I'm thankful for my bedroom. My younger brothers have to share a room, but I have one all to myself. The next little boy said, I'm thankful for my puppy. I'm so glad God let me get one as a birthday present. Another boy thought for a moment and he said, I'm thankful for my glasses. Your glasses? The teacher was surprised, and she said, well, why are you so thankful for your glasses? And he said, because it keeps the bigger boys from hitting me and the girls from kissing me. See, knowing is important. And last of all, thanksgiving is giving thanks. It's just that. Just to make sure that we get this, the psalmist tells us twice, enter with thanksgiving and give thanks. This is about coming to church. This is about not showing up wanting to get something to take home with you. That senior luncheon, we give you boxes for take-home stuff. For worship, it's not about what you take away. It is about what you give away. in your worship. This is all about showing up with something to say to the God who loves you. This is about sharing what God has done. This is letting the redeemed of the Lord. You're learning. This is all about being the one instead of being the nine. This is about being the one instead of the 17. Thanksgiving is about praise. Shout. Make it public. Be happy. This is not pie in the sky. There is a foundation for praise, and it's found in the character of God, who is good, whose love endures forever, whose faithfulness continues through all generation. Let me wrap this up. Are you ready to give thanks? I'm not talking about in November on Thanksgiving Day, and I'm not talking about turkey, ham, and sweet potatoes. But I mean, are you ready to start giving thanks today? Somebody wrote this. I'm thankful for the taxes I pay because it means I'm employed. I'm thankful for the clothes that fit a little snug. It means I've had enough to eat. I'm thankful for my shadow who watches me work because it means I'm in the sunshine. I'm grateful for the spot I found to park at the end of the parking lot because it means I'm capable of walking. I'm thankful for my huge AC bill because it means I've kept my cool. I'm thankful for the pastor in church who sings off key because it means that I can hear. I'm grateful for piles of laundry because it means my loved ones are close by. I'm grateful for the alarm that goes off in the early morning hours and wakes me up because it means I'm alive. I'm grateful for weariness and aching muscles at the end of the day because it means I've been productive. The art of thanksgiving, it's gratitude and action. It's thanking God for the gift of life, but living triumphantly. It is thanking God for talents and abilities by accepting them as obligations to be invested for the common good of others. It is thanking God for all the men and women that have done for us so that we can now do for others. It is thanking God for happiness and the willingness to make others happy. It's thanking God for beauty by helping make the world more beautiful. It is thanking God for inspiration by trying to be an inspiration to others. With all you've got, the best you can, will you worship Him? Let's pray. Our Father, for what you wrote into David's heart so many hundreds and hundreds of years ago, may somehow you make it fresh in our lives. May church not just be a place we come to relieve our guilt, but may it be a place that we come to celebrate our life in you. For some of us, Lord, who are here today, it's a change of attitude. For some of us, it's a willingness to obey. For others, Lord, they don't have their first personal experience with you yet. And so I pray that this might be the morning in which they'll say, Lord Jesus, I don't want to be caught as a goat in the wilderness. I want to be identified as a sheep in the pasture of the great, glorious shepherd who loves me with unfailing love. So, Father, for whatever it is that each of us need to discover from your word today, may we be willing to receive it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's leave the way in which we should arrive. Let the redeemed of the Lord.
Say so.
Let the redeemed of the Lord.
Say so.
Better this last time. Let the redeemed of the Lord.
Say so.
Woo! Go love Him today. All right, have a great day.